And on this note, I would like to say that this was the way of our predecessors. They refused to be reliant upon anyone for their rizq, for their money, for their daily bread, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're human beings. Like everyone else, they need an income. But their freedom to advocate the truth with minimal pressure from a financier, that to them was a greater requirement. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a remarkable hadith, he said, مَا أَكَلَ أَحَدٌ طَعَامًا قَطُّ خَيْرًا مِنْ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ مِنْ عَمَلِ يَدِهِ وَإِنَّ نَبِيَ اللَّهِ دَاوُدْ كَانَ يَأْكُلُ مِنْ عَمَلِ يَدِهِ. He said, nobody has ever eaten a better meal than the one that he has earned with the working of his own hands. He said, and the Prophet of Allah, David, Dawood, he used to eat from the earnings of his manual labor, from the earnings of his own hands. Allahu Akbar. This financial independence is key for the Shaykh, for the student of knowledge, for the active Muslim. In fact, Abdul Basit Ibn Yusuf Al-Gharib, he authored a book where he lists around 400 different professions that belong to no less than 1,500 scholars of Islam. Who said that you have to have no worldly profession to be a scholar of the religion? This is a life lesson, brothers and sisters, this desire to earn independently. We learn this life lesson by just looking at the nicknames of many of the scholars of our religion. What were their nicknames? Look, for example, you have Al-Zajjaj, the glassmaker, Al-Qaffal, the locksmith, Al-Najjar, the carpenter, Al-Haddad, the blacksmith, Al-Bazzaz, meaning the draper, Al-Attar, the perfume seller, Al-Qassab, the sugarcane worker, Al-Jassas, the plasterer, Al-Khabbaz, the baker. These are nicknames of scholars whom we know and we read about and marvel over their biographies. So this was always the case in our Islamic history, up until maybe quite recently, when da'wah and Islamic scholarship became a job title, which one reaps a salary for, like any other job. And in many cases, this would subsequently be abused by their finances, who would constantly threaten to cut off their wages if they don't comply or carve out the fatwa, the Islamic position that suits them. So the Shaykh is now speaking on demand and remaining silent on demand. That is not appropriate. The scholars before us therefore sought to have the upper hand and to be financially independent, relying only upon him.